Well, the curtain comes down. There is certainly quite a bit of bittersweetness hanging in the air on this final day of racing. Day number 40. 40 up, 40 down. Labor Day 2015 at Saratoga Racecourse. We are off and running. Saratoga inside of Swan Song. Richard Migliori, Jason Boyd alongside. Hope you had a terrific Labor Day. Glad you're settled with us on MSG+. And just like that, 40 up, 40 down.
Feels like we were just starting. It seemed like opening day was yesterday, but then it was groundhog every day. Get up, come here, exciting racing, great action, do the show, get something to eat, go home, go to sleep, do it all over again the next day.
But the game's a part of us, and there's no place on earth like Saratoga Racecourse, and this was one of the greatest summers at the Spa ever. We have a quick headline to get to. It wouldn't be Saratoga, at least over the last 3 or 4 years, without mentioning Wise Dan. We won't see him next weekend at the Woodbine Mile. We do wish him the best of luck in retirement. What a racehorse.
Yeah, unfortunately, he has a tear in his tendon. Not the ankle injury that he was dealing with before. That was tight, but unfortunately, he will be retired. But fortunately, you know what? He'll have a good life now. I'm sure they'll turn him into either a riding horse or he'll just be a very pretty pasture ornament.
One of the best milers on the turf in this country over the last quarter century. I put him right up there with Lore, and I mean that from the bottom of my heart. Thank you for everything, Wise Dan. A couple of graded stakes on the program today, Mig. The place was rocking, a sold-out crowd. It felt like a sold-out crowd anyway. Sun was out. It was a warm Monday. Let's see what happened in race number 9, the grade 2, Bernard Baruch.
They're off in the Bernard Baruch, and it is all included on the outside in Constitution and now Grand Tito. Constitution, Grand Tito go out to the front together. And then it's Vijack, and all included is taken back off the pace to sit fourth early as they race into that first turn. Ironicus hugs the hedge, and he's fifth. 6.5 lengths off the lead and right alongside of Under Control and Charming Kitten, who's 3 wide on that turn. So Constitution takes the initiative onto the backstretch. 23-1 was the quarter, and Constitution has moved away to a 2.5 length lead on Vijack. Grand Tito tracks them third by another 2.5. And then it's Under Control, followed by All Included. Ironicus is right alongside of Charming Kitten, and they are 6 lengths off of front-running Constitution and Joel Rosario, who go by a half mile in 46 1/5 seconds. It's been a solid tempo here for Constitution, who leads the way into the far turn. Grand Tito is second to the outside. Vijack is third. Under Control follows fourth midway on the far turn. 4.5 lengths off the lead. Ironicus is still in behind horses. All Included in Charming Kitten are right alongside. And Ironicus is beginning to run on now. He's within 4 lengths of the lead. But he's got Constitution to catch. 3/4 up in 109-2. And they're into the stretch. Constitution trying to hold on for another furlong. And here comes Ironicus with Dead Aim on the far outside. Vijack is there along with Grand Tito, and they're into the final 16th, and Ironicus has taken the lead. Grand Tito, Vijack, Late Move, All Included on the far outside, but Ironicus has won the Bernard Baruch, and then it was All Included, Grand Tito.
Powerhouse, classic Shug McGahee, and how about the effort from the gray Ironicus? Didn't pull the easiest of trips, but he was more than good enough to blow by everybody.
Well, this pace wound up having a lot more pace than everybody anticipated, and he took full advantage of that. And I like what Javier Castellano did, Jason. Saved ground early because he knew he was going to have to give it up late. And track record performance, broke the track record in this Bernard Baruch. And Ironicus, he's the leader of this division, as far as I'm concerned, the mile turf division, particularly now with the retirement of Wise Dan.
And he's got the master in his corner, Shug McGahee, alongside Maggie Wolfendale.
Winning trainer of today's Bernard Baruch. Shug, excellent job with Ironicus. Denied just a neck in the four-star Dave, but he came back and crushed four-star Dave's record today.
Well, I knew he could set the course record. I didn't know who it was. Well, yeah. We came up here to run into four-star Dave, and I thought he ran a great race. A really nice horse beat him, and I really hadn't planned on running here, and he came out of that race so good. You know, I called Stewart about a week later, and I said, you know, maybe we ought to take a look at this thing. And he continued to train good. I breezed him a couple times, and both of them were very well, very good, and he came over and ran his race. So
he really did, and you got to be hopeful looking forward down the line to Keeneland. Breeders' Cup Turf Mile, is that in his future?
Well, I mean, obviously that's what we're hoping for. I'm not really smart enough to plan all those things that far in advance. But that's what we got, you know, that's what we got in our minds. And, you know, whether we go the Shadwell Mile or not, or just train him up to the Breeders' Cup, I'll just have to wait and see. But, you know, either one of them are pretty good options.
Well, Shug, well done with Ironicus. 5-for-11 lifetime. Got to be pretty happy.
I'm happy. It's really, really a nice horse to see him come over here and run this way. Makes the trainer happy.
Congrats.
Thanks.
And there is the new track record, 38.54. The previous track record, the Sultan of Saratoga, four-star Dave, achieved it July 29th, 1991. Mick, that was a course record on the Mellon at a mile and a 16th that stood for over 24 years.
You know, it's remarkable that it stood that long. It speaks volumes about four-star Dave's talent. But it also speaks volumes about Ironicus's talent. And it's a little bittersweet because I always liked looking up and seeing four-star Dave track record. But you know what? Records are made to be broken. And I think a very worthy horse took it down.
Homebred for Stuart S. Janney, four-year-old by Distorted Humor. Those Shug turf horses just get better with age. Let's move on to the other stake on today's card. In fact, the Grade 1 action came to a close at around 6 p.m. Monday evening, the Grade 1 hopeful $350,000 purse, Larry Colmus from the gate.
They're off in the hopeful. And it's Magnolite who goes out to take the early lead and immediately opens up to lead by a length and a half over Uncle Vinny and Rallis, who are away second and third. And squeezing through on the inside, Salisaw and Set the Trap is right up there too. And then back to Tom's Ready, Bullet Gone Astray trails as Magnolite leads the way through the opening quarter mile in 22 3/5 seconds. And it's Magnolite on top a length and a half. Set the Trap is running in second. Rallis is third to the outside. Salisaw has the rail with a half mile to go. Uncle Vinny's got 4.5 lengths to make up, starting to be ridden along. And then it's Tom's Ready on the inside, who's gone by Uncle Vinny. And Uncle Vinny's not going on here. Around the far turn, it is Magnolite. Magnolite is the leader, and here's the Californian Rallis, who has moved up alongside, and these two will come to the top of the stretch together in the hopeful of 45 2/2 mile, and they're into the stretch, and it's Magnolite in front. Rallis runs at him as they come into the final furlong. They've left the others behind. Salisaw's third, and Rallis has taken the lead. Rallis rallies to the lead in the hopeful and pulls away from Magnolite. They're coming down to the line. And Javier Castellano wins another Grade 1 at the Spa. He takes the hopeful on Rallis. And then it was
Cowbred by Square Eddie. Rallis, Saratoga debut in from the West Coast. Doug O'Neill, Redham Racing, and Javier Castellano, 6 Grade 1 wins of the 17 run this summer at Saratoga.
Well, Javier Castellano wasn't the leading rider in number of wins, but he was the leading rider in money earned and quality of wins. And this horse, Rallis, was absolutely good. I think having his 4 starts previous to this is being his 5th start, that foundation to get 7/8 helped him, and I think the distance is what he wanted. I think this is a good horse going forward. I was on the set on the far turn, on the clubhouse tournament, and he galloped out by me very strongly, like a horse that will continue to like more distance.
Good horse will come from anywhere by a $1,000 California Stallion. Javier worth a lot more. Here he is with Maggie.
Here with winning rider Javier Castellano of today's hopeful aboard Rallis, a horse you've never been on before from the West Coast. Did Doug give you any instructions for him?
Yeah, well, I spoke to yesterday the way he tried to handicap the race, the way he can set it up. The whole tactic of speed, but a lot of speed in the race, the way he looked to me. And he brought way out of the gate, just a full position, good stocking position, grow from there. And Tony Fajon did a potential finish.
He really did, and you're the Grade 1 king. 6 Grade 1s this year in 2015 at Saratoga. How's it feel?
I feel great. I'm very thankful, and I mean, a lot of people, they give me a lot of support to be basically number one jockey in the Grade 1 here in Saratoga. It's a good record, you know, and especially, you know, be proud to be participate the best jockey in the country, and a lot of support. My agent, my trainers, the owners, I mean, it's a team effort.
It really is. Javi, well done once again.
Thank you.
6 Grade 1s at the meet for Javier Castellano. And look, the lesson I learned from today's 111th running of the hopeful, you got to be in it to win it. Doug O'Neill, probably sensing this was not a vintage edition of the hopeful, decided to ship Rallis, and now he's a Grade 1 winner.
Now, one thing we got to remember, though, these are young horses, and they're going to change a lot. These are like high school athletes. By the time they start their three-year-old year, they're college athletes, and they'll go on and become professional athletes. So they've got a lot of development to still do. I thought Magnolite ran well. He was under the gun from the inside. He had to use his speed. I also think Uncle Vinny is going to be a better horse when they put blinkers on him. He runs so spotty. He quit running completely into the far turn, backed up, looked like he was going to be last, and re-rallied to be third. I think this is a horse that just has focus issues. So I think we got to be fair with them and just see how they play out as they get stronger, they get older, and more mature mentally.
And the day just getting started for Doug O'Neill. 8:40 if you want to fire up Naira.com. They run the Del Mar, the Grade 1 Del Mar Futurity. He has got Nyquist, an overwhelming favorite by Uncle Mo. We've got fillies and mares battling on the turf when we come back.
The new Parks Fall Festival will double purses for each of its 32 live racing days. What an opportunity for Pennsylvania Breds. In an open maiden special, PA Breds will run for over $100,000. So be there at Parks in the fall.
Hello, I'm Brian Sanfratello. Last year, we paid $33 million to PA Breds in the form of breeder awards, owner bonuses, and restricted race purses. Our equine coalition group is united in the pursuit of making sure that we receive every dollar we deserve. And that's why our Racehorse Development Fund has been constant in the past 4 years. Please go to our website at www.pabred.com or give me a call at 610-444-1050.
Saratoga is done. Training will commence here tomorrow at 5:30 a.m. and across the street at Oklahoma. And it's also going to commence 5:30 Tuesday morning down at beautiful Belmont Park. Admission gates open up this coming Friday for opening weekend. First race post, 12:55.
Yeah, back to Belmont Park. And hopefully the weather will cooperate and get just a little bit cooler, because today certainly didn't feel like we were on the edges of autumn.
No, this was a good day to grab some shade in the spacious backyard at the spa, and even the people behind us in the paddock, the horses as well. A sultry Labor Day up and around 90 degrees as we get it going in race number 8. This kicked off the final pick 4 of the summer at Saratoga. Big field, 3 and up, fillies and mares in this allowance. Here's Larry.
Tide is high, comes out running quickly from the inside and goes out to take the early lead. Gap Year is away in second, and then it's Southern Gem followed by Crown Doro, and on the far outside, Divine Praises, as they race by us for the first time. Southern Gem is down on the inside, saving all the ground there, about 5 lengths off the lead, and right in behind is Ortega as they go into that turn. And then it's back to Runner Runner, who's second last early on ahead of Fila Primera, the trainer. 23-1, the opening quarter mile, and Tide is high, and Eric Consell go on with it. They open up to lead onto the backstretch by almost 4 lengths here over Gap Year in second. And there's a gap behind Gap Year as Crown Doro follows in third and is now 7 lengths off the lead. After that comes Southern Gem, Divine Praises outside of Ortega. And then it's Runner Runner, who is second last at this stage of the race with 12 lengths to make up. Fila Primera trails after a 46.5 mile. Tide is high, rolling along into the far turn, chased by Gap Year. And Joel Rosario, and they're now 2 lengths behind and 5 lengths ahead of Crown Doro in third. After that comes Southern Gem, Divine Praises to the outside, and they're into the stretch, and it's still Tide is high. 3/4 in 109.2. And coming to the eighth pole, Gap Year runs on by. It's Gap Year to the front. Ortega is trying to get going late. And then it's Runner Runner on the far outside. It is Gap Year in front as Ortega takes second. And then it's Tide is high and Runner Runner. It is Gap Year to win it. And then a photo between Ortega and Runner Runner.
Gap Year full of run. Second consecutive turf race for this daughter of Bernardini at the meet. And she looks like a turf filly with the future.
Yeah, she really does. I love the way she finished the deal here. Again, Joel Rosario, one of the strongest finishers around right now. Kieran McLaughlin just capping off an absolutely wonderful Saratoga meet.
Same can be said for Bernardini this closing week and weekend at Saratoga. You have Cavorting in the Prioress, Rachel's Valentina in the Grade 1 Spinaway, Greenpoint Crusader, who had the faster two-year-old division maiden win on Saturday, and now you've got Gap Year, who's out of Dubai Escapade, who looks like a filly who's going places.
Yeah, I wonder with Bernardini, they took so many of them to Europe, Sheikh Mohammed, that maybe they weren't cut out to be European-type turf horses, and now that it looks like they're concentrating more of the Bernardini's in the States, maybe we're going to see a little more success out of him, because I know that he's gotten the best mares to him, and you know, we've all kind of taken little pot shots at him here now, but I think he's starting to emerge as the stallion they thought he could be.
Yeah, no kidding. All of a sudden, I'm like, oh, we might be seeing, I mean, this is next level Bernardini, not one grade one horse every now and then who's a bit of an underachiever. Good stuff this closing week. Let's move on to the Super 6. Day number 40, sealed main track. In fact, we were fast and firm with the Harrow track, and here they come off the quarter pole. 2, 4, 5, 6, 7, and the spa nightcap.
Ladies first surprise cameo. Nose to nose into the final furlong together. Frosty Ann is up into third and she's gaining ground late. It is surprise cameo and ladies first Frosty Ann 2.5 lengths behind them. Surprise cameo, ladies first Frosty Ann, Moonshine Kate closing late. They're down to the line. And it was surprise cameo who held on. And then it was ladies first, Frosty Ann and Moonshine Kate. In front, Fars to the outside is second. And then it's Infinite Wisdom in third. Coming through on the inside, Taylor Fancy trying to close in. A furlong to run. Battle Red still there, Infinite Wisdom. And then Fars followed by Tweet Kitten between horses. Battle Red, Infinite Wisdom coming. Battle Red holds on. Infinite Wisdom was next, and then Tweet Kitten and Tail of Fancy. Home on the lead. Twice Mike in front as they come to the top of the stretch. And then it's Unstoppable You, followed between horses by Mr. Palmer and Bimata to the outside. Twice Mike and Manny Franco still there, and they've put some daylight in front of the rest. Twice Mike is five in front. And rallying into second is Spring Court, but Twice Mike won for fun. Spring Court was second, Mr. Palmer was third, and then Unstoppable You. Top of the stretch, and Miss Aja Brown has slipped through on the inside, and Miss Aja Brown has taken the lead at the top of the stretch. Love the Kitten tries to battle on. Late speed coming from Theory of Change, who's closing through and closing quickly on the inside into the final 16th. It's Miss Aja Brown drifting out, and Theory of Change coming through on the inside. Miss Aja Brown, Theory of Change, Theory of Change. Up the rail to win from Miss Aja Brown. And then it was Wing Fury and Kusama. Slam still there, a 45.5 mile. Here's Uncle Cy now with a clear run at the front runner with a furlong to go. It is still Colorado Grand Slam. But now here's Rectify with a rush. She went by Uncle Cy and Whale Rock. And Rectify is closing on the far outside. Coming up after the front runner and going on by. And it will be Rectify and Junior Alvarado to win it. And then it was Colorado Grand Slam, followed by Whale Rock and Euros to the stretch. Kitsy's Rocket on the outside is the leader. Rock Me Again digs in. These two will fight it out in the final furlong. It is Kitsy's Rocket on the outside. Rock Me Again continues to battle. And then it's Voila La Victoire, followed by La Hinge Classics, and they're coming down to the line. And Kitsy's Rocket has won it over Rock Me Again, Voila La Victoire.
Thank you very much, Cappy. Second look on this Labor Day 2015. Let's not go back very far. Race 11, they hit the wire shortly after 6:20 p.m., and it was Kitsy's Rocket capping a wildly successful summer at Saratoga for Trainer Barkley Tagg.
Huge percentage on Barkley Tagg, and it just seemed appropriate that he closed the meet with a win. He started the meet with so many first-time starters that he, you know, they cracked the first time out, and he's such a good horseman. It was nice to see him have such a strong meet, as well as several other horsemen. You think about Jeremiah Englehart. I mean, he had a breakout Saratoga, the best Saratoga he's ever had. But we're happy for Barkley, a horseman's horseman, a guy that knows how to get it done.
Yeah, good. Well, good way to put it. Well said there, Mr. Migg, as we just have one page of claims to bring you. Augie's coming. Jason's coming for my English Cocker Spaniel, Augie, down in Floral Park. Horse didn't run too well. A well-bet firster for Kimball, claimed by Danny Gargan. A few other claims, including our last five-way shake of the meet.
Wow. You know, so many horses were popular with the same people. They were shaking all over Saratoga.
All right. Augie's waiting for me. August Belmont blew it. And we'll take a look back at the summer that was here at Saratoga. Back at the spa, getting dark outside, around 7 p.m. as we get back to the final segment. And there was some finality in the air today, but Todd Pletcher didn't slow him down. He picked up a couple wins on day number 40 for his 12th Saratoga training title.
Really good stuff. It was a great battle between him and Chad Brown, two guys that pulled out all the stops. It looks like they tried to run every horse they possibly could run in the last 3 days to get it done, but Todd was able to pull it out. What's impressive about it, too, Jason, is what he came off of Belmont, where you expect maybe some sort of a lull here. Well, even with the lull in the middle of the meet, he was able to come back strong. Great trainer's title.
Number one all-time at Saratoga with Maggie.
All right, here with, once again, Saratoga's leading trainer, Todd. Since 1958, you have by far won the most training titles here. It's your 12th. It's your 6th in a row. How does that feel?
It feels great. You know, it's a lot of fun for our staff. A lot of people put in a lot of hard work and, you know, a lot of excitement. This was a really, really tough meet to win. Chad Brown and his team had a phenomenal meet, and it came down to the end, and we were fortunate to have some key wins over the, you know, last few days.
Yeah, as you said, Chad made it very tight down to the last day. Was it as thrilling for you as it was for the fans?
It was. I mean, you know, I think I was surprised at how many fans and how many people said, you know, that they were really keeping a close eye on it. So I do think it added some excitement to the end of the meet.
And you usually do superb with your two-year-olds. This year you had a really good mix. I mean, you won tons of greatest stakes, as you usually do. But what kind of led to that? Because you did very well with your older horses as well this year.
Well, I that was one of my concerns coming into the meet, is I felt like we were pretty strong in the older horse category. And you know, while that's great, those are really hard races to win. And I was concerned. I didn't feel great about our two-year-olds coming into the meet. And, you know, we were able to come away with some good wins, but not the depth that we generally have.
Well, Todd, congratulations once again. Keep up the good work.
Thank you.
We'll be hearing from Mr. Pletcher downstate at Belmont beginning Friday, day number one. 34 wins for Todd Pletcher. Chad Brown, a great summer as well with 31.
Yeah, I'm sure Chad Brown's disappointed, but he shouldn't be, because he had a tremendous meet as well. And it's like two good horses drawing away from the field, and they left some really good horses in their way. Bill Mott, Christophe Comant, and company.
Leading jockey, Irad Ortiz. He is the fourth youngest rider to win a title up here since the late 50s. And, I mean, this is a young man who's got the world at his fingertips.
He really does. 23 years old. If he stays healthy, there's no telling what he could accomplish. He could be the one that passes Johnny Velasquez in all-time earnings records, because the purses keep getting bigger, and he's only 23 years old. He is the future.
He's so likable. Here he is with Maggie. Oh, I apologize. We got Irad Ortiz. My bad. 57 wins for Irad Ortiz and clinching his first ever Saratoga riding title. Javier Castellano, however, a half a dozen grade one victories and fitting swept both graded stakes today.
And, you know, here he is, Javier, only 4 wins behind Fleet Ride, but he won all the quality races and he did things that riders have never done before in the history of Saratoga. Good stuff.
Eric Consell, not a bad job as the 5-pound apprentice, as Michael Dubb successfully defends his Saratoga owner's title.
And a man that always has a plan. Like I said, he's a man for all seasons. He knows when to claim horses that are going to run good at two turns or different places, works hard at it, and gets rewarded.
And I just want to thank these outfits. I think you share the same sort of opinion. I mean, they're the people that pay the bills and make the show, or help the show go on.
Absolutely. If these people didn't continually invest in our game, there would be no game.
Top spa moments, let's do it. Rachel Alexandra, her offspring, went a perfect 3-for-3. You couldn't have scripted this. If you had scripted this before the meet, I mean, I would have hit you.
Yeah, no, you know, Rachel Alexandra, most fillies that are really good race mares don't turn into really good brood mares. Well, that's not the case for Rachel Alexandra. The shame is we're probably only going to see these two foals out of her.
And here is Jess's dream in another county. I mean, he was at the harness track when they hit the 6-furlong pole in his debut, and somehow, some way, here he comes for Kira McLaughlin as Barbara Banky and Stone Street went 7-for-14 this summer.
Just a horse who had no idea what it was all about, and when he figured it out, he just decided he would strut his stuff a bit, and he finished like a turf horse, but on the dirt.
A Whitney to remember. This is a Whitney, for me, Behrens Victory Gallop, Skip Away Formal Gold Will's Way, right up there with Liam's Map and Honor Code 1-2 in that desperate finish.
Yeah, this is like an unofficial classic, this race to Whitney. It's always delivers, but this year especially delivered with Honor Code running down an extremely good Liam's Map, and I think Liam's Map coming back in the woodwork just flattered both of them.
And Liam's Map, the big Tour de Force 114 buyer. We will dive deep into the 60-second Woodward on the Racing Report Tuesday and Wednesday at 7 p.m., but this was some exclamation point to the summer up here for Liam's Map.
A tour de force, and he, if anybody thought the Whitney might have been a fluke or that maybe the number wasn't right, well, all they had to do is watch the Woodward and go, wow.
How about Private Zone in the forego? He's fast, he's a bully, he doesn't want to be passed, and he's got Grade 1 galore trophies on this circuit.
And Martin Pedroza fits him to a glove because he's the same exact way. He's a bully. He doesn't want to get fast. He's tough, just like this horse. And they really, really complement each other.
Triple Crown drought, 37 years. That came to a close Saturday, June 6th at around 6:45 p.m. American Pharoah taking the Belmont Stakes. And would you have ever imagined you'd ever see a sight like we're witnessing on the screen? 20,000 in attendance the day before the Travers watching this great Triple Crown champion gallop in front of the stands at the Spa.
Jason, I was in the winner's circle, and I had goosebumps. It brought me back to when I first fell in love with the game. This was everything that's good about horse racing. People were excited just to see a horse. They weren't here to bet on him. They weren't here to wager. They were here to watch greatness work out.
Life moves so fast. Technology, smartphones, the internet. It was nice, and although American Pharoah didn't win the Travers, he ran terrific, and it was nice with his presence to just bring it down a notch. Here's a masterpiece created by nature, and everybody just enjoying this great specimen.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, we were so hungry for a Triple Crown winner, and I know people were disappointed when he got run down by Keen Ice, but you know what? There's no disappointment in losing. All great champions lose. It's the shame in not showing up to compete. Well, he showed up, and we could thank the Zayats. We could thank Baffert for that. And Keen Ice is a developing horse, a horse that's continually improving. Let's give him a little credit. I mean, he got a little assist. You know, American Pharoah was entertained up front, but it took a good horse to run him down in Keen Ice.
And the plot thickens as autumn arrives and things will eventually get a little cooler. We'll get back to Belmont Park. We've got the big Breeders' Cup preps there. And regarding what this Breeders' Cup Classic could be like, even forgetting about Beholder and they decide to run in the BC Distaff with her, this is a classic with a Triple Crown winner and a supporting cast of just so much equine talent.
Well, it's great the fact that we're going to see a Triple Crown winner compete in a Breeders' Cup, because the last time we had a Triple Crown winner, there was no Breeders' Cup. A lot of time has passed, just like this meet. It went by pretty quick.
And we need to thank the fans. Thank you for the support. Greatest fans in the world.
Absolutely.
And want to thank the horses as well. They are everything, and they give us everything.
Yeah, the horses, the horsemen, the jockeys, the owners, absolutely the fans, and it's been great working with you all summer.
Same here, Meg. Thank you for tuning in to Insider. And from Saratoga Racecourse, we say good night.